Hello, welcome to This I Believe. I'm recording the first part of this first session again, so that it'll be a little clearer for you online. So welcome to This I Believe. Let me get a set up here so you can see the screen. And we are good there. You should be able to see this PowerPoint throughout our time together. So we're going to be talking about crafting our personal faith statements. What does it mean to put together a statement of what we believe? Tonight, this first night, we're going to be focusing on faith statements from the Bible, some scriptures that are statements of the Bible, from people in the Bible and worship in the Bible where a statement of faith is made. Next week, we'll look at faith statements from our Christian tradition and from our Baptist tradition, where groups of believers came together and crafted statements of faith. And then on the third week, we'll look at how do we craft our own statements of faith? How do we put together a statement of what we believe? And then in the following weeks, as we need to, we'll be sharing those statements with each other. So I hope you'll join us for all these weeks. These videos will be posted on our website under Hominy Online. And you can watch those at your leisure. But to get us started tonight, I always like to use music. So watch an oldie but goodie here first.
I believe for every drop the rain falls, a flower grows. I believe that somewhere night, a candle glows. I believe for everyone who goes astray, someone will come to show the way. Someone in the grave somewhere hears every word. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry,
listen to this one from a later time.
But now I know the meaning of true love. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. If I can see it, then I can do it. If I just believe it, there's nothing to it. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly.
In both those, there's a sense of a statement of things that they believe about how the world works, and there's also a sense of what a person believes they're capable of doing and how they have hope in the future. Those are pretty strong statements of belief that are from a person. Now we're going to look at some scripture, but before we look at the scripture, we need to look at what we're talking about when we say the word believe in scripture. Some of you have heard me talk before about the Greek word that the Gospel of John uses for believe, this pistevo, which is a verb form of the word for faith. So it would be kind of like saying faithing instead of believing. And it's very important that we remember that that means when the scripture talks about believing, it's not just a one-time thing. You know, I believed on this date, and that's all that mattered. No, it is an ongoing process. What are you believing in as you move along? And it's not just mental agreement with an idea. You know, I believe that the sky is blue, or I believe that North Carolina Panthers are the best football team. It is a matter of faithing, of trusting would probably be a better way to put it. What is it that you trust in enough to guide your life? And that's the kind of believing that we're talking about and that the scriptures talk about. So we're going to look at these faith statements in the Bible. And as you look at these on your own, think about what jumps out at you from this passage. Why do you think this passage was chosen to include in the scripture? You know, why this? Why was this important to the people who put it in the scripture? You know, we know that the Holy Spirit guided them, but what was it that resonated with them that they said, this is something that God wants in the scripture? And then what does it say to you? In this video, we won't be able to hear back from you, but I hope you'll be thinking about those things as we look at each of these scriptures. So the first one is perhaps one of the oldest faith statements. You may not realize it, but the book of Job is often thought of as being the oldest written down portion of the scripture. There are stories that are older, but this is maybe the first one that was written down, and we really think it's one of the oldest stories as well. So listen to Job 19, beginning with verse 25. "For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, then from my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see on my side, and my eyes shall behold, and not another." And what jumps out for me is this is Job talking, and this is at the very end of the book of Job, after he has endured so much devastation and death and suffering and what he feels like is unjust difficulty that has been poured out on him, and all his friends have left, everybody's left, and he is able to make this faith statement. And he says, "I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that God, the one who will make all this better, lives. And when it's all over and done with, he will be here on the earth. And after I'm dead, and after everything I have is gone, I will see God." So it's this tremendous statement of faith. After going through all this suffering, he knows without a doubt, he has faith. He believes that his Redeemer, that God lives, and God will outlast this, and he will outlast this, and he will be able to see God. God, even if no one else is there. So that's an important, the first statement of faith that we find in the scripture. All right, let's look at another one. This one's a little longer, but it's also very old. It's in Deuteronomy 26, and it's in that section where it's giving them instructions about giving offerings. And this is the first fruit offering, the harvest offering. And so the instructions begins, "Then you shall declare before the Lord your God, my father was a wandering Aramean, and he went down into Egypt with a few people and lived there and became a great nation, powerful and numerous. But the Egyptians mistreated us and made us suffer, subjecting us to harsh labor. Then we cried out to the Lord, the God of our ancestors, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our misery, toil and oppression. So the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with great terror and with signs and wonders. He brought us to this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And now I bring the first fruits of the soil that you, Lord, have given me. What jumps out at you on hearing that?
That we're supposed to give our well, to me, it's that you're to give your tithe.
Okay.
Yeah, bring the first fruits. Do that first before you keep any of the rest for yourself.
Okay.
I think the part about the, where they brought him out of Egypt and with his hand and outstretched arms and great terror, which must have been the splitting of the seas and signs and wonders. You know, that would be something.
Mm-hmm.
You have to keep saying thank you, you know.
Yeah.
Well, no matter what all they had been through, they still trusted and brought first to God.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Anything else jump out at you?
Paul?
Yeah.
Okay, he says my father was a wandering army man. Okay, so who's talking?
Who is that?
Yes. I mean, we're sitting here.
That's probably.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Probably referring to Jacob. As being a son of Abraham who went down, you know, Joseph went down and had his experience, and then he sent back, his brothers came, and then they ended up bringing the whole family down. So that probably refers to Jacob. Okay. And what's kind of interesting to this is, you know, this is this confession of faith or whatever you want to call it is written down many years later. You know, because, you know, they wouldn't have been alive if he went down with Jacob, you know. So it's my father. But then it says, but the Egyptians mistreated us and made us suffer, subjecting us to harsh labor. So he's kind of making that whole story personal. You know, it happened to us. Even though the person who's saying this many years later was probably not there in Egypt. So part of worship was retelling this story. And this is one of the real, you know, you can read this over chapters and chapters and chapters in Exodus. But this is a couple of places in the Old Testament. They had this very short retelling of the story of what happened to the people in Egypt and how God brought them out of it. And that is why they do fill in the blank. You know, whatever they're doing, they do it because this happened. Anything else jump out at you there? So that's why it's important. You know, it's telling that story. And that was very important for the Jewish people. That's where they got their identity, was they were a part of this story. And it's almost like it happened to them. So what does it mean to you today?
That God keeps his promises.
Okay. Yeah.
He listens to us when we cry out, when we are in need.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we cried out to the Lord and the Lord heard our voice. Yeah. It's interesting to me there that there's some phrases there that you've heard all your life. And they're all over the Old Testament, but they're in this passage where he talks about cried out to the Lord, brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand, brought us to this land flowing with milk and honey. You know, those are all phrases that get used over and over talking about this story, the story of the people of Israel. All right, we're going to go from a long one to a short one. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. What jumps out at you there?
That there's only one Lord.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't even think about that.
I know.
But for them, that was a big deal to say that. And to say that that was the center of their faith, is that the Lord our God is the only Lord. Yeah. What else?
And we're to love the Lord our God with all our heart and with all our mm-hmm. soul.
Yeah.
And no, love no other, like the statues and little things yeah. that they used yeah. to do, to have other gods, and we're not supposed to have but one God.
Anybody else? What jumps out at you?
Isn't this sort of like our saying at our church, that the sign that oh, yeah. we have above the door? Yeah.
That's what our mission comes from. This yeah. is from Jesus yeah. quoting this. Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, we don't think about it. We don't think about God being, there just being one God. But we also don't think about our relationship being with him about loving God. But that was a big deal, because the other God, the other statues, was about fearing. And that if you didn't get your sacrifice in on time, your crop wouldn't come in and your children would die. And everything bad would happen to you because you made God angry. There was no sense of loving Baal or Molech or any of those other gods of Palestine. It was all about fear. And it took them for a while. There was still some of that left in the Old Testament too. But at the very center of their faith was love the Lord your God. So that's a big deal. That's a really big deal. All right, anything else? What does it mean to you? All good? Okay, we'll go to the next one. On to the New Testament. And again, this is one of the oldest parts of the New Testament. We don't think about that too much, but that the letters were written down before the Gospels were written down. You know, the stories of Jesus were being passed on from person to person. They'd been around since Jesus, but they weren't being written down until after Paul's letters were written down. So,
and when were those, Paul?
Probably 50 or 60, so about 20 years after Jesus. And the interesting thing about this passage here is we think that maybe this contains the first little written down description of what Jesus did. So he says, "For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, and then to the 12. Cephas is the other name for Peter, if you don't remember that.
Yeah.
So this is the Easter in a nutshell.
Was that Paul saying that yeah. after yeah. he had found out about, because he was not with the disciples.
Right. So this is what was passed on to him.
Yeah, later on. And yeah. yeah.
So he's passing on to them what was passed on to him.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's writing it down.
That's the only way that we have knowledge of what did happen, was by handing it down mouth to mouth.
That's a very good point.
And was put on paper then later.
Yeah. And you know, I remember a long time ago somebody said, that Christianity is only one generation away from extinction.
Yeah, and if it had
Christianity is only one generation from extinction. So if all the Christians right now stop telling the story.
Yeah.
But we got a problem.
Paul, if it hadn't been for Paul in the New Testament in Corinthians and on through there, Christianity would not be like it is today.
Right. Because he spread it out beyond Palestine, beyond the Holy Land, all over what became Europe.
Yeah.
Anything else that jumps out at you on that one? Okay. We'll go to another one from 1 Corinthians. Same kind of pattern. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." That should sound a little familiar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We often use that in worship.
Yeah.
What else jumps out at you from that?
Well, that it's just actually it's to symbolize, I guess, is the word I'm trying to say.
Yeah. Ritual.
Yeah. Ritual.
So this is where we got the pattern for where we, how we do Lord's Supper.
Wow. Uh-huh.
Probably more so than, because, you know, the Gospels all tell the story, but they all tell it a little bit differently. So we typically use this one as kind of our pattern for doing the Lord's Supper. Anything else jump out at you there? All right, let's look at another one. Some short ones now. Jesus is speaking to the disciples. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God."
Well, there were a lot of people that were saying he was different things.
Yeah.
John the Baptist and all of these other different prophets and so forth. But he's asking them, who do you say that?
Who do you say that I am? Yeah. So, and I think that's a critical question when we're talking about what our faith is and what we believe. It's not what somebody else says. It's what you say. And so when we're shaping our own statements of faith, it should be our own words. It's what should be what we say, what we believe. And not just what somebody else told us. Now, we may take what somebody else told us, like Paul did, and pass it on, but it's going to be in our own words, and it's going to be based on our own experience.
And from our own heart.
Yeah. And from our own understanding.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, let's look at another one. All right, this one, I think Joe preached on a month or so ago. The man comes to Jesus and wants his child healed. And Jesus says to him, if you're able, I know you'll heal him. And Jesus says, well, if you're able, all things can be done for the one who believes. And immediately the father of the child cries out, "I believe, help my unbelief." What jumps out at you there?
I don't understand. If he said, "I believe, help my unbelief," what was this?
Yeah.
Tell me what that means.
Anybody else got a thought on that?
Well, it's kind of, you know, I don't understand it exactly because it's kind of confusing. Mm-hmm. Like Gail said, "I believe, but help me. Help my unbelief," mm-hmm. because he's already saying, "I believe," mm-hmm. then he's saying, "Help my unbelief."
when you're saved, the immediately after you get saved, it's like what do I do now? I don't know how to, you know, show my belief or, you know, teach me. I have my unbelief that I can reassure myself.
I think he's saying, I believe, I'm sorry I said if.
Okay.
If you're able.
Yeah. And I think it's all of those things. And I love it that this is in the scripture, you know, because it kind of shows us that when we say we believe, it doesn't mean we've got it all worked out. You know, that I'm going to trust you with this doesn't mean that I understand it all. It doesn't mean I know how it's going to work. It doesn't mean I know what the steps are going to be or anything. It just means I trust you with this. I trust you, my child. Help me have the faith to go through with this. Help me understand what's going on. And I think it just reminds us that with belief, there is always this mixture of uncertainty. If you're certain about it, not so much faith is necessary. So there has to be an element of, you know, I don't know it all, but I'm willing to trust.
Mm-hmm.
And so I love it that that's in the scripture.
Yep.
Sometimes Satan can kind of push that little doubt in there too sometimes, you know.
Absolutely. And we've got to just hang on to the part that we trust.
Yes.
All right, let's look at another one. Speaking of doubt, a week later, his disciples were again in the house and Thomas was with them. And though the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God."
Well, old Thomas had already said that he wouldn't believe until he had put his proof.
Yeah.
So he had to have proof.
And he had to put his finger in there and reach out and touch him.
Right. So not necessarily that whether we believe that God is God or Jesus, but that so many times we ask for something and we don't actually believe that it's going to happen. Maybe we ask, but we just ask hoping, I guess, is the word. And we don't have the faith that we should.
Yep. Thomas just said, you know, I'll believe it when I see him for myself.
Right.
And it's interesting, Jesus quotes back to him what he said, but then Thomas doesn't need to touch. He doesn't need to put his finger there. He doesn't need to put his hand in his side. He comes with this, one of the strongest affirmations of faith, "My Lord and my God." You know, he doesn't just say, "Oh, I'm glad to see you, Jesus." He knows that Jesus is God in that moment. What else jumps out at you from that one?
Well, I guess, isn't this where Jesus just appeared to them through all the doors was closed and he just...
Came through the walls. He just appeared to them.
Yeah.
So a very supernatural kind of experience there for them.
Thomas. How could Thomas not believe then
when he
or not, you know?
Yeah.
Well, it never says he touched him.
No, he didn't.
He totally didn't have to if he wanted to, but Thomas believed without touching.
All right. Let's look at another one here. All right. Now, this one is very different than the other ones. This is from Philippians 2. Familiar passage. But you may notice it's laid out a little bit differently on the page. And that's because scholars believe that when Paul wrote this down, he was quoting something that they said in worship. We don't know if they said it, you know, like a liturgy or if it was a song, but it was something that they were familiar with. So I'll read that. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. What jumps out at you from that passage?
Well, that's saying that Jesus is God. If we want to know what God looks like, just look at Jesus.
Yeah.
As Jesus is portrayed in the scriptures. And that would tell us what God is like. And his teachings, the way God teaches, Jesus taught.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? What jumps out at you?
Well, down in verse 9, about that God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. And, of course, I guess he just picked that name out. How did he have that name, Jesus?
Well, Jesus was named that early on.
Yeah, it means God saves.
Jesus.
It's related to the it's Yeshua, which is close to Joshua, which means God saves.
Is that what the word Jesus means?
Yeah, God saves.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Yeah. And so and I think in some ways it doesn't matter that his name is Jesus. I think it is that person, Jesus, was exalted, and that his name was going to be a name that was on everybody's lips from then on.
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, yeah.
How did he come up with the name Jesus? And he could have said Paul.
He could have said what? He could have named him whatever.
Yes.
Whatever that name was, it was going to be exalted among all because of what Jesus did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, wasn't Mary supposed to name him Jesus when the very beginning of Jesus?
Yep, that's where she got the name. The angel told her, you're going to call him that. Yeah.
His name will be called Jesus, or he will be called Jesus.
Yeah.
Because that was preparing him for later years of what was going to happen. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what I understand.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That's right.
On the first part, though, it says, who being in every nature God, he did not consider himself equally with God.
No.
Something to be used. He just didn't feel like it was a God.
To look like what God looks like, what God would be like.
Well, he didn't consider that being equal with God. And this translation says something to be used to his own advantage. Some translations will say something to be grasped or to be held on to. And so a lot of folks will say what it's saying is Jesus was God, you know, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But he was willing to let go of that in order to come and be made in human likeness. He was willing to let go of that complete power in order to be like us.
Yeah.
Yeah. So be this.
Human.
Yeah. So this language is a lot more formal than any of the other ones.
Yeah.
It was kind of written up for worship. But it's trying to get at some real basic principles about who Jesus is. It's a little more complicated. It's a little more formal. But it's still stuff that is really, really important to know who Jesus is. That he wasn't just another person, but that he was with God and was willing to let go of that. Anything else on that passage? All right, I think we got one more. And this is familiar, but very different. This is from Philippians. And this is Paul speaking. And he says, if someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. Righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead.
Yeah. Was Paul writing this?
What jumps out? Yes.
Who was writing this?
This is Paul.
Okay.
So what jumps out at you about this passage? It's very different from the others.
Well, it's got a lot of Hebrew and is the stuff in there that he's talking about. I think that he may be trying to explain to him that circumcision is not about to be saved, because later on Peter gets into trouble with that. Mm-hmm. And I think Paul's trying to explain some of it.
Yeah.
Sort of like.
Yeah. In that first paragraph, he talks about how he's given his pedigree, about how he was a perfect Jew.
Yeah.
If you wanted to boil it down in a nutshell, he was as good as you could get at following the law. And then in the second paragraph, he said, but all of that I count as loss compared to Christ. And he goes on about, you know, how much that is true. And that, when he says, I consider them garbage, it's a much stronger word than that. So he is really saying, all that was so important to me before, it was my life.
Yeah.
Compared with knowing Christ, it's worth nothing. So this is kind of Paul's testimony. And he does some other places like that too. Anything else jump out at you from that passage? All right. Okay. So what do you notice about these? What do you see? Something in common, something different, something that, you know, means something to you when you think about them all together? What do you think about them?
Well, I think that it all relates back to how we feel or believe and Jesus.
Okay.
What our faith is, that, you know, I think all of them sort of resemble that.
Yeah.
And they're all different.
Mm-hmm. All different, but they
have
all
different understandings.
Yeah, but they all just about mean the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Same meaning, just different understandings. I mean, that's what I think.
Okay. Anybody else? I wanted to share with a couple of things that I thought about. One is that all of them are responding to God. God did something, and the person felt like they had to write it down or express it somehow. Whether it was the delivery from Egypt or meeting Jesus or asking for a child to be healed or Paul's discovery of Christ, God did something and they felt like they had to respond. So it wasn't about what they did. It was about what God did. The second thing that jumps out to me about all of them is it's all kind of personal. It's about what happened to them. And even in that passage talking about what happened to the people of Israel, it becomes personal to him. You know, it happened to us. God delivered us. So there's a sense that it's about what God did with me in my life. The third thing, and this is not true for all of them, but it is true for several of them, that it's about worship somehow, that these statements became a part of our worship because they were very meaningful to us, and they captured something that we wanted to say in our worship. So if you go to a Jewish synagogue service, you're going to hear, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. You're going to hear that. That happens in every single Jewish worship service. You're probably going to hear that passage about my father was a wandering Aramean at some point, not every service. The passage that talks about the Last Supper, you know, we use those words. Those are very familiar words that we use in worship. So these words become important and we share them, and they become, when we hear somebody else's story, that can become a part of our worship. And then that brings us to the last one, is there's all in all of them, there's a sense of story. It's not just facts laid out. It's not just principles. You know, he could have said, you know, step point one, Jesus was with God. Step two, Jesus left God. You know, step three, you know, Jesus became a human. It's kind of told in a story form. And the same way with the people of Israel, the same way with the Last Supper. You know, he could have said, this is what you need to do. First, you put your juice out, then you put your cup out. No, he told the story. And so part of our faith statements, we can think of, there needs to be something about our story in them, about why this is important, rather than just what we believe. So I think that's important. All right. Anything on that? And then we'll close out. I want to do one more thing. Any questions? All right. We began with a song. I want to end with a song. And don't worry about not seeing the picture here. I'd rather you hear it. And I think you'll hear it better if I do it this way. Oh, you're not hearing it, are you?
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me he hath made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed before his own. But I know believe.
One of our favorite hymns.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And what I love about it is, you know, each verse says, I know not. It goes through something, and then it comes back to the chorus, but wow. I know whom. Uh-huh. I know in whom I have believed. So there's a lot of things we don't know. A lot of things we don't understand. You don't have to know it or understand it all in order to believe and have faith.
Right.
We have to know whom. And it's the whom in Jesus that we have faith. And it's the whom that we're able to trust. Even when we don't understand anything else. That's who we have trust in. All right. Anything else before we go?
We going to have it next week?
Yes. Next week, we'll look at some statements of faith from Christian tradition and Baptist tradition. And kind of get narrow things down a little about some things that people have thought were important to be a part of our group faith statements. All right. All right. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for faith. Thank you for those who were faithful before us and who passed their stories on so that we might be encouraged, that we might know their stories, and that we might be able to follow you and find our own story in you. Lord, help us to believe. Help us in our unbelief. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 All right. Thank good you, Paul. To see you folks.
Okay. Good to see everybody. Bye.
Love you guys. Love y'all.
Bye. Have a good week.
Have a good night. Good week. Rest of